Hello, everybody, and welcome back to the next episode of Keeping It Catholic. Today we are on the fourth part of the Story of Salvation series. We are almost through. I'm sorry that I'm posting a little bit late in the week this time, guys. That is my bad. Got a little behind. We've had some friends in town, so I've been a little bit distracted. But today we're going to talk about the fourth covenant that God now expanded. We started with one couple that God started his covenant with. That was with Adam and Eve. He then expanded that covenant to one family with Noah and his family. He then went on to extend that even larger to one tribe with Abraham and his tribe. And he's now going to expand it today one further with one nation, and that is going to be with Moses. We are now several generations later in the Bible. We have passed, far past, Abraham and Isaac, and we are now with Moses. We are seeing Isaac's son, Jacob, who is renamed Israel and is often referred in the Old Testament as Israel. He carries on the covenantal blessing. All 12 of Jacob's sons leave the promised land of their forefather Abraham, and they end up in Egypt. It is in Egypt that these people are made into slaves after the Egyptians turn against them. The Israelites are enslaved for 400 years. And so eventually, that's all they know is slavery and Egyptian culture. The land that was promised to Abraham, their forefather, is now just a distant memory. But God remembers his promise. Today we're going to start in the book of Exodus chapter 3 and read verses 1 through 12. Meanwhile, Moses was tending the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian. Leading the flock across the desert, he came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There, an angel of the Lord appeared to him, in fire flaming out of a bush. As he looked on, he was surprised to see that the bush, though on fire, was not consumed. So Moses decided, "I must go over to look at this remarkable sight and see where the bush is not burned." When the Lord saw him coming over to look at it more closely, God called out to him from the bush, "Moses, Moses," he answered, "Here I am." God said, "Come no nearer. Remove the sandals from your feet, for the place where you stand is holy ground. I am the God of your father," he continued, "the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob." Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. But the Lord said, "I have witnessed the affliction of my people in Egypt, and have heard their cry of complaint against their slave drivers. So I know well that they are suffering. Therefore, I have come down to rescue them from the hands of the Egyptians and lead them out of that land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the country of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. So indeed, the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have truly noted that the Egyptians are oppressing them. Come now, I will send you to Pharaoh to lead my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt." But Moses said to God, "Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and lead the Israelites out of Egypt?" He answered, "I will be with you, and this shall be your proof that it is I who have sent you. When you bring my people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this very mountain." So here we see God appearing to Moses in a burning bush and asking Moses to lead the Israelites out of slavery, away from Egypt. And Egypt is this powerhouse back then. This is the time of the pharaohs, the time of the pyramids. Egypt was a great nation, a great kingdom at that time, a great empire. And so here's Moses, one old man, and God is saying, "You're going to go free my people from Egypt." And not only is Moses kind of old and random, we also know from chapter 2 of Exodus that Moses is a murderer. And this is kind of the beauty of God's plan, that even someone that we don't think is a good candidate or a good fit to serve God is still loved and desired by God to become a good fit. And this is what we see in the Old Testament a lot, is that the Christian is not someone who never sins. The difference between a Christian and a non-Christian is not perfection, it's repentance. Moses was repentant. Abraham was repentant. Noah was repentant. It's not that they were perfect. In fact, no one that we've looked at in the Old Testament so far has been perfect. Almost every single one of them has committed a serious sin against God. It is not the fact that they have not sinned. It is the fact that they repented. We're now going to move forward a little bit. Still in chapter 3, we're going to read verses 18 through 20. Thus they will heed your message. Then you and the elders of Israel should go to the king of Egypt and say to him, "The Lord, the God of the Hebrews, has sent us word. Permit us then to go a 3 days' journey in the desert, that we may offer sacrifice to the Lord our God. Yet I know that the king of Egypt will not allow you to go unless he is forced. I will stretch out my hand, therefore, and smite Egypt by doing all kinds of wondrous deeds there. After that, he will send you away." So God goes on to command the Egyptians to let the Israelites go. But it's not just for the sake of freedom, actually. If you read the text carefully, you see that what Moses is actually asking for is for the Israelites to be able to go on a 3-day journey to worship. Why then is this so important? Because the real slavery that God is trying to fight is a spiritual slavery and not a physical slavery. This isn't to say that God is okay with slavery or thinks that it is a morally good thing or even a morally neutral thing. In fact, God does think that slavery is a morally evil thing. However, God's primary concern and our whole role of being here on earth and going through this life is to get ourselves to heaven and to reach salvation and to help other people do the same thing. And so if you aren't spiritually minded, if your mind isn't set on your eternal life, whether it's heaven or hell, this can be kind of confusing. If you're just set on materialism, if you're just set on worldly things, this isn't going to make much sense to you. But God knows that the finite is just not as significant as the infinite. And so his concern here has way more to deal with the spiritual suffering, the spiritual slavery that his people are going through, because that is what dictates whether someone gets to spend eternity with God or not. Not what they actually physically endured on earth. And in fact, church teaches, and Christ himself teaches, that physical suffering actually helps redemption, which is why, in part, why Christ suffered and died on the cross. And we will talk more about that later. His suffering redeemed the world. And now through that, his death and resurrection, our suffering can also be redemptive. So that is a little explanation for something that's a much larger topic that we will talk about later. So a big part of this is while the Israelites have been in Egypt, they have kind of taken on the culture, the life, and especially the worship of the Egyptians. And the Egyptians are pagan. They're worshiping many gods. They are not worshiping the one true God. And so God is trying to remove the Israelites from Egypt so that he can remove the Egyptian idolatry out of the Israelites. Of course, when Moses goes and asks Pharaoh if he can take the Israelites just for 3 days. Pharaoh refuses, and that is when Moses and the Israelites have to leave completely. We will then go on to see that the Lord sends 10 plagues to Egypt, and these plagues are not random. In fact, all of the plagues that God sends to Egypt are Egyptian gods that they worship. So for instance, he turned the Nile River to blood. The Nile River was a god to the Egyptians. He sent a plague of frogs. They worshiped frogs. And basically what God is saying is these gods are actually gods. I'm the one true God, and I have power over all of these things that you worship. Particularly because when God sent the plague of frogs, I mean, they were everywhere. They were probably even stepping on them, smashing them with their feet, and that would have just been incomprehensible to the Egyptians who worshiped these frogs. And God is saying, stop worshiping these things. They aren't God. I'm God. Your gods are dead. The final plague will not only test the Egyptians, but also the Israelites as well. And I'm going to jump forward to Exodus 12, verses 21 through 23. Exodus chapter 12, verses 21 through 23. Moses called all of the elders of Israel and said to them, go and procure lambs for your families and slaughter them as Passover victims. Then take a bunch of hyssop, and dipping it in the blood that is in the basin, sprinkle the lintel and the two doorposts with this blood. But none of you shall go outdoors until morning, for the Lord will go by, striking down the Egyptians. Seeing the blood on the lintel and the two doorposts, the Lord will pass over that door, and not let the destroyer come into your homes to strike you down. So with this 10th and final plague, we see the angel of death coming, and he is going to kill the firstborn of anyone that does not have lamb's blood smeared on the door lintel. And so when the angel of death sees the lamb's blood on the doorpost, it will pass over the home and people will avoid death. And the death of the lamb will take the place of the son. So putting the lamb's blood on the door was more than just a sacrifice. The lamb was also a god of the Egyptians, and to kill one was a capital offense, which means that anyone that killed a lamb would be sentenced to death. And so, in other words, God was kind of making it apparent, yo, you have to choose me or choose the Egyptians. There is no fence sitting. But God also wanted them to trust in him, that he would protect them when they left Egypt. This is what they call the Passover. And this is a very, very, very important thing. This is a very, very important celebration to the Christian, where I'm going to have to make a whole other video just to talk about the Passover and what it signifies to the Christian today, because it is so important. But this is a reminder to us that we need to sacrifice the idols that we have in our own lives, even if we think it's going to have drastic consequences or if it seems impossible to us. You'll notice here, like I said before, that God is really demanding of the Israelites that they cannot be fence sitters. I have had so many interactions with people that call themselves Christians that really love to sit on the fence. You know, they don't want to, you know, go too far to one side or the other side, and they don't want to offend this group and they don't want to offend that group, and so they sit on the fence. But God makes it very clear, he does not like fence sitters, and this has been something that the church fathers have taught as well throughout history. In fact, in Dante Alighieri's Inferno, we see he actually has a circle of hell dedicated just to the fence sitter, because they are so detested in the eyes of God. There's a reason that God says that you can't serve two masters. You'll either hate one and love the other, or love one and hate the other. There's a reason for that. That fence sitter, you can't be a fence sitter and a Christian. You're gonna end up losing. losing. And that's what he's trying to say in this passage. So keep that in mind, something to meditate on. So this final plague works, and the Israelites, they ditch Egypt and they head out, they cross the Red Sea, and after they have gotten out of Egypt and everyone is safe, God renews his covenant with Moses and the entire nation, the people of Israel. We're now going to jump super far ahead in Exodus chapter 32, verses 1 through 6. When the people became aware of Moses' delay in coming down from the mountain, they gathered around Aaron and said to him, come, make us a god who will be our leader, As for the man, Moses, who brought us out of the land of Egypt, we do not know what has happened to him. Aaron replied, Have your wives and sons and daughters take off the golden earrings they are wearing and bring them to me. So all the people took off their earrings and brought them to Aaron, who accepted their offering. And fashioning this gold with a graving tool, made a molten calf. Then they cried out, This is your God, O Israel, who brought you out of the land of Egypt. On seeing this, Aaron built an altar before the calf and proclaimed, Tomorrow is a feast of the Lord. Early the next day, the people offered holocaust and brought peace offerings. Then they sat down to eat and drink and rose up to revel. So in what seems to be a tradition, as soon as God brings these people into safety and as soon as he renews his covenant with his people, they rebel against him. So Moses at this point has gone up to the mountain to pray and to talk to God. And while he's gone, the Israelites have grown impatient. So they go to Moses's brother Aaron. They ask him to make a god who will be their leader. And they say that it's because they don't know what happened to Moses. So this may seem like an odd request, but just because the Israelites are physically free, they are still spiritually enslaved to Egypt. Essentially, they miss their old ways. Aaron agrees and he makes a golden calf for them. And this was the Egyptian fertility god. So at the end of the verse, we see that they sat down, ate and drank, and then they rose up to play. And this is another Hebrew idiom, to rise up and play, for basically having an orgy. It's a Hebrew idiom for sexual immorality kind of in general. And so they basically just had a massive idolatrous orgy. Yeah, never thought you'd see that in the Bible, but you do. So meanwhile, while Moses is up on the mountain, God tells him kind of about what's happening down there. And so he sends him back to go address the Israelites. This is something Protestants get very confused about, because in the Catholic tradition, we have many paintings, statues of Jesus and other religious figures, Mary, Joseph, the apostles, the gospel writers, etc. We have a lot of artwork. And God will say in the Bible, don't make graven images. Well, you have to put this in context, because what's crazy about what's happening in this passage is that the Israelites, even though they saw this golden calf literally being handmade by a human being, they truly believe this object to be God, a god, because that was what the Egyptians believed. I mean, the Egyptians would have these little statues often, and they would put them in these giant temples, and they would literally believe that these statues were God or a god, and they would bring food to the statue and expect the statue to eat the essence of the food. I mean, just like weird stuff. And so God says and makes it a rule or a law or a commandment not to make graven images, because so that you're not worshiping them. And that's different than making artistic images that point your eyes upward toward God himself. We don't worship the actual statues. We don't care if the statues get broken. We don't care if we don't treat them special. We're just there. All they are physical reminders of who our spiritual father is. And that is completely different than what's happening in this context, where they truly believe that this golden calf is a god, and the calf itself affects the weather and and has power in the world. They literally expect that this physical man-made object has unique power. And that is just such a key difference. And I think that can be really hard for Protestants to wrap their mind around, because that's not something that we have as much of an issue with today. It actually looks in different ways. A lot of people idolatrize their phones, their homes, their job, stuff like that, and kind of worship those. We don't really have as much of an issue of worshiping statues as much today. It still is common, especially not as much in the West, but in the East. So just a little side note on that, and we'll kind of talk more about that later. The last thing that we're going to read for our Bible study today is Exodus chapter 32, verses 25 and 26. When Moses realized that to the scornful joy of their foes, Aaron had let the people run wild, he stood at the gate of the camp and cried, "Whoever is for the Lord, let him come to me." All the Levites then rallied to him. So once again, Moses is drawing a line in the sand and he says, whoever is for God, you're coming, come to me, and whoever's not, go. And this is once again against fence sitters. God is anti-fence sitter, and it cannot be more apparent. He's this way in the Old Testament, and he's in this way in the New Testament. There is kind of a misconception that God is like for fence sitters. No, he makes it very clear that he is actually very anti-fence sitter, and the early church fathers knew that well. If you read early church history, you'll see that the early church fathers were against fence sitters as well. God wants you to have conviction. He wants you to choose a side. And even though he wants you to be loving, people often think that loving means to be accepting of everything and anything, when really what love is to will the good of someone else. And to will the good means to will someone's virtue, to will that they get to heaven. You get to heaven by being a virtuous person, by living by God's commandments. And that's what love actually is. That can require difficult conversations, that can require uncomfortable conversations, that can require there to be awkwardness, to be tension, to be conflict. But God calls you to all of it. He doesn't, you know, there's this mushy-gushy love is typically kind of pushed forth by people that don't read their Bibles, that don't know the history of the Bible, that don't know it in context, haven't read early church history, and are just kind of picking up the Bible as a 2022 American or Western person and just reading it and thinking they got it all because they read something in English that's been translated from Greek and Hebrew. You're gonna and not know any context that it was written in. You're not gonna get very far, unfortunately. So at the heart of this idolatry is the idea that God's not going to satisfy us. And so we think that we need to go and find things to fill our satisfaction, to fill our needs and find satisfaction in other things. This is a temptation that everyone has, even if they have God in their lives. Sometimes God feels silent or like he's just not there, or we slip out of something that was kind of a habit. We can just fall off the wagon altogether and just go back into our old pattern of sin. But we do have a responsibility to fight against idolatry, both in our own lives, but also in the lives of others. And Moses really modeled for us how to do this. You'll see that when Moses witnessed other people sinning, he took action immediately. First and foremost, he didn't participate in it, and he doesn't try to win over their favor. Moses has no care about whether these people think that he's a great dude or not. All he does is simply call them to holiness. He asks the entire nation of Israel, "Who is on the Lord's side? Come to me." And he draws a line in the sand, and he makes the Israelites decide whose side they're on. And sadly, only the Levites choose to join Moses. And this is where we are Christians are called to be. It isn't about trying to win a popularity contest. We're not trying to make everyone like us. We're not trying to say what's going to get us the most points and make us look the most cool to our neighbors, to our friends, to our family. There is objective truth. There is objective things that are good and not good. There's objective truth in what is holy and not holy. And it is our responsibility as Christians to say to somebody with charity, hey, what you're doing is not the right thing to be doing. And to give them that choice. Where are you going to go? Who are you going to decide to serve? God or yourself? Moses does not make everything nice and cushy. He doesn't tell the Israelites, hey, what you're doing is okay. You do you, I'll do me, we'll all get along. No, that's actually the opposite of what he does. He makes it very firm that what the Israelites are doing is objectively wrong, objectively immoral. He doesn't say you do you. That's actually never in the Bible, ever. Not a single person says you do you, I'll do me, you do you. This probably made some of the Israelites very uncomfortable. Probably made them feel awkward. Probably made them feel maybe even isolated in some ways. A lot of them probably didn't like Moses after he did that. And then obviously many of them didn't choose to do what Moses asked. They chose not God. They chose that they didn't want a relationship with him. The majority, in fact. And that is what it means to be a Christian is, you know, it's not a popularity contest. You're probably not going to be the most popular person, and that's something that God makes very explicit. People probably aren't going to like you that much for saying that what they're doing is not the good thing. And that's a theme from Genesis to Revelation in the entire Bible. So, unfortunately, the people that have come up with other things typically haven't read their Bibles or really understand what's going on in them or early church history or anything like that. So in conclusion, God has finally extended this covenant to an entire nation, and this is represented by the Passover. Moses is a great person to have a model for us of how to call others higher into holiness. And once again, if you keep in mind from the beginning of our Bible study, Moses was not perfect. It does not require someone to be perfect to call someone else higher. It requires repentance. Moses was repentant. He understood that what he did was wrong. He made amends with God and he tried not to do it again. It's not that he was perfect. It's not that he never sinned. That isn't a requirement for calling people higher to holiness. Repentance is a requirement. That being said, if you are a practicing Catholic or if you are a Catholic at all, I invite you to consider going to the Sacrament of Confession. I will make a video series in the coming months on the importance of confession. The video will include where confession is in the Bible. It will include where confession was in the early church. It will include all of the teachings on confession and the importance of going to confession. But I invite you to consider to go to confession. I know that it can be very scary at first. That is why you should go often. The more you go, the less scary it will be. And get on the road. It doesn't matter if it's been 2 weeks. It doesn't matter if it's been 30 years. Trust me, I go all the time. It's not that bad. The more you go, the less hard it is. And there is nothing that you have done that the priest has not heard a million times over. As you can see through this Bible study, none of the early church fathers were anywhere close to perfect. All of their sins, in fact, were very, very severe. We had adultery, we have murder, we have drunkenness, we have a whole host, we have rape, we have a whole host of things the early patriarchs of our faith committed. But the difference was the repentance. So I ask you to please consider going and repenting of your sins in the Sacrament of Confession. With that being said, that concludes our video for this week. I will see you guys next week. I hope you have a great rest of your day, a great rest of your week. I will be praying for you. I hope that you will be praying for me as well. We are almost finished with this Bible study. I'm very excited about it. If you have any questions or any comments, please email me at keepingitcatholicask@gmail.com, and I will talk to you guys next week. Bye.